What do you think, behaviorally speaking, humans primarily are? That is, do you think we have a sort of Hobbesian human nature or plastic human nature or something else? Because this seems to, when you hear either conservatives or liberals or people on the far right or far left discuss what kind of policies and what kind of economics and what we should have, you know, how we should deal with the rest of the world, it usually always or often comes back, at least to justify their opinions, it always comes back to, well, this is what humans are, and this is therefore more natural for us to do A, you know, have a capitalist society, or B, have a socialist society. What do you think is the basic human nature that, or do you think that we have a basic human nature?
I believe that we are part of the natural world, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, we have a nature. It's our genetic endowment determines substantially what our nature is. In fact, if you look at the growth of any organism, us, bees, you know, yeast, whatever you like, there are actually three factors that enter into its growth and development. One is its genetic constitution, another is environmental effects, and a third is just the way laws of nature work, which is a turns out as a major effect. And the inquiry into biological organisms takes all of those into account, or should. As for our human nature, the genetic endowment that we essentially share, very little is known about it. I mean, it's just a really hard question. And as I mentioned in our earlier discussion, a lot of the ways of studying it are excluded, simply because we don't allow invasive experimentation. It's hard enough to learn about insect nature, where we allow ourselves anything, and they're much simpler organisms. So what do we know about human nature? Well, most of our knowledge comes from history, experience, literary exploration, and so on. That's what our knowledge comes from. What does it tell us? It tells us that, of course, humans are partially plastic, like I don't speak Swahili, for example, so we're partially plastic. On the other hand, there has to be an enormous uniformity at a level right below the surface. And what we see on the surface is a wide range of possibilities. I mean, we see people who are acting in a beastly fashion. We see others who are kind of sacrificing their lives to save dolphins.
One of the sciences, and I'm not sure if it would be categorized a hard science or a soft science, or it's an emerging science, evolutionary psychology. People like E.O. Wilson and Steven Pinker have come around and said they understand what human nature is, and it's based on this new science. Are you saying then that they're either still just guessing, or do they have some scientific backing that from what you have, if you have read any of their work?
Yes, I know their work. And I know a lot of them. What's now called evolutionary psychology was in fact initiated over a century ago, by Peter Kropotkin, the anarchist thinker and naturalist, who wrote a book called Mutual Aid, a Factor in Evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And in it, he investigated, he was basically trying to counter social Darwinists. He was Darwinist himself, and he argued by looking at a lot of naturalistic phenomena, other animals, human history, and so on. He argued that if you look at it, you discover that mutual aid had provided a selectional advantage, and therefore organisms had evolved through selection, including humans, to be deeply committed to one or another form of mutual aid. Well, you know, that's not what elite opinion wants to hear. They want to hear some other story. So therefore, Kropotkin's form of evolutionary psychology essentially disappeared.
Right.
It's been revived to some extent. The modern state of evolutionary psychology, it's not that there's no science there at all. There's some, you know, like say kin selection is real, reciprocal altruism is real, a couple other things are real, but very little is known. It's thin. You know, this is not physics, and it's not molecular biology, it's not chemistry. It's largely guesses. It's a worthwhile topic to pursue. You know, it's a fine topic to pursue. In fact, that's where my own professional work is in particular areas. But scientists particularly should be very cautious about deluding the public to think that they know more than they do.
Mm-hmm.
Science is held in enormous respect for good reasons. And therefore, scientists have a responsibility to make very clear, here's what we know and here's what we don't know. And what we know in these areas happens to be extremely thin, not because they're not good scientists, but because the questions are too hard.